doing, May, for all of your work here and also the support of SPARC. Also, I'm really grateful to NC Live for inviting me here to speak with you a little bit about open education, leadership, and how that plays into our practices and values on campus and beyond. And my talk here is going to go sort of a trip down memory lane, talking a little bit about my development as an individual leader in this space. Then talk a little bit about how the OER movement has progressed over time, and then wrap up by talking about leadership and leadership lessons and how we can all work together to combat some of the challenges that we're going to be facing as we move into the future of course materials. So I should note before I start that I have 130 slides, and I'm going to try to get through them in about 45 minutes. Basically, and there are a lot of links and articles that I'm going to show. All of them are cited, and I will be posting the slide deck online under open license, so you can go back and find all those references, so don't worry if you miss things. So I want to start with the theme of this conference, which is about the future of system, and we'll come back to a couple of times. But I think to really think about the future, we do have to look into the past. And I want to take you back to 2005, when I was an undergraduate student at the University of Puget Sound in Tacoma, Washington. And I was in my final year of college, and this was during the Bush administration. Congress had actually just proposed a huge $12 million cut to federal financial aid programs to pay for tax cuts. And as a student, I was fortunate to not face financial barriers, but so many of the students around me did. I saw the impact that it had, you know, even if they're part of a large college where, you know, theoretically the students have access to more means. You know, there were students who were working two jobs in order to afford their education and taking out hundreds of thousands of dollars in debt in order to get a degree. And I thought as well that the government would be cutting funding from programs that are meant to help students. So as a student activist, I got involved in an organization called the Washington Public Education Group, and worked with students across the state of Washington to implement a key swing vote on the Hill. That we talking with some other students about the importance of reducing student debt. And the key swing vote was my Republican right outside of Seattle, and it came down to the day before the vote on this vote. And I got together a bunch of students from schools across the state, you know, hopping the vans, ground rain, Jefferson's pouring rain in Seattle. We had to cover these signs we need in clear packing tape to prevent them from melting in the rain. And we stood out there for hours. And eventually somebody came out of the office. So we were outside of the office chanting and asking for us to hold on to. And somebody came out of the office and asked to speak with the leader. And it wasn't really until that moment that I thought of myself as the leader of this initiative. And at first I was like, oh, you know, I'm in trouble. But what actually ended up happening is that she brought me upstairs and put me on the phone with the congressman who stepped off the floor of the U.S. House the day before a big vote and took a half an hour of time to listen to what I had to say. Of course, I didn't know anything about the details of federal policy, and you know, now as an expert in federal student aid policy, I'm with them. And you know, almost blush at the idea of participating in a congressperson without even knowing about all of the intricacies. But what I did know is what it's like to be a student and the experience of the students on my campus and campuses across the state. And came over what I had to say. And while the next day it did not come to vote, what did happen is that over the next few years, he ended up voting with us on a number of key student aid reforms that made things better for students. So there is into the open education space, and I've spent literally my entire career working on this issue since then. And I went through, after this whole experience of working on federal financial aid policy, I started to think about, you know, it's not just about reducing the price of education that students pay, so increasing programs and getting more access to loans to students, but also paying more out of pocket. It's actually, we also need to talk about reducing the costs. So, you know, it's not necessary to find that much financial aid in order to pay for other costs. And when you look at the breakdown of what students are spending their money on in higher education, we all know that the bulk of it goes to tuition. There's also, you know, living expenses, there's transportation, there's other expenses like childcare. And those are all expenses that are very difficult to tackle on a systemic level. They require large, coordinated policy level changes. In some cases, society level changes. But that life goes right is and depending on what type of institution, the recommended budget is somewhere between $1,200 and $1,400. And you know, not all of that goes to textbooks, but that's a slice of the budget that students have to pay to get an education that we actually can have its impact on locating. Because it literally comes down to decisions that individual faculty members make. And while it's something that we can't necessarily change in every case and every case, it's something that where we can find opportunities to have an impact right there. And it's especially important because from a student perspective, the cost of textbooks really is a significant issue. It's not just the dollar amount. It's that the textbook costs often come out for students to party to for their other expenses, tuition, room, board, fees. It's that additional straw that breaks the camel's back and often puts students further into debt, goes on credit cards, student delay purchases, and you know, cuts to divorce and purchases. And I started working on this issue in 2007. And we were in a very, very different place than we are now. There was the rising cost of textbooks had already been going on for many decades. I'm going to come back to this graph in a minute. The cost of textbooks, this is an actual slide that I just used in talks when we discussed high textbook costs. Principal of Economics textbook in 2007 cost $157. In 2017, it cost $406. Yeah. And there's actually a whole economic explanation for why these prices are so high. Explained in this book, but you have to be able to afford it. So back then, the issues that students were facing were largely around ideas like textbook bundling, where there would be shrink wrap CDs and other workbooks that forced students to buy new textbooks. There were new editions coming out every 3 years that forced students to buy a new edition and sell back the used edition. And you know, these kinds of things have continued, but just in different forms. But one thing that has been consistently true over a number of years is about 2/3 of students, the space get by from the materials because of the cost of the test. So, at the end of the day, students can't learn the materials that they can't afford. And if we're going to try to make an impact on higher education overall, it's not even just about reducing the cost. It's also about eliminating those cost barriers that actually have a negative impact on student outcomes and student success. So it was also in this time, so 2007-2008, where the open education movement really started to gain steam. There's something called the Cape Town Open Education Declaration, which some of you may have heard of, maybe some of you have not. It starts with the phrase, we are on the cusp of a global revolution. And this declaration was really the first major articulation of the idea of open education as a transformative force for the future of education. And it was the fact that this document does articulate a vision, it's not just talking about replacing expensive textbooks with new textbooks, but it's actually about finding ways to increase participation of students and teachers and shape knowledge together, so people all over the world can get access to an unlimited amount of knowledge and contribute back to that. And enabling new forms of teaching and learning that actually improve the educational experience and really take full advantage of the technological innovations that we have now to expand access and you know, the different ways that that can play out in different contexts. But the most I found was, in terms of what was practically happening on the ground, it was very much about open educational resources. So we are the actual teaching and learning materials that make open education possible by providing the content as a form of infrastructure. And I want to be a good open education advocate if I didn't at least cover what open education means. So when we use this term open, it means something very specific to describe educational materials. It means that materials are free, and at least one form, so free of cost and free of barriers. And they come with permission to freely use them in all of the ways that are possible in the digital environment. So, and that's often described in terms of the 5R framework, retain, to be able to keep and control a copy forever, to use materials in any context you want, revise materials and remix them, and combine materials to create new locally relevant versions, and then finally you distribute. So share it in any format you want, print, digital, online, offline, with anyone, anywhere in the world. And when we talk about permission, we do talk about copyright permissions. And there's a great example of the Creative Commons licenses that provide a spectrum of permissions. Generally, the more open of the licenses would be considered OER, but there's still many steps in that direction that can be really positive in terms of just sharing resources online or using library license materials that are at least free to students on campus while not open or steps in the right direction. So the open education movement early on is very much focused on OER in different websites and repositories. So I think one of the first projects that many people heard of is the MIT Open Courseware Initiative, which actually started in the early 2000s. And this project basically took the MIT great materials that MIT professors were already creating in the course of their teaching and encouraged them to fully share them online so that everyone can benefit from them, as opposed to just the few thousands who attend MIT every year. And the result is that over 300 million people worldwide have actually used these materials and benefited from them. They've been translated into a bunch of different languages, and it's actually improved MIT's stature in visibility and worldwide. And they've actually found that some of the international students who come and apply to MIT are learning about MIT through the materials that they share. And over 200 other institutions have established similar programs. So there are also, and continue to be, these large repositories of materials online. So OER Commons is one, Moodle is another, some contain non-open resources, but hundreds of thousands of different materials online. And there were a few open textbooks. So in 2007, 2008, I was working for the Student Public Interest Research Groups on a campaign called Make Textbooks Affordable. And the first thing that we did was to do a survey just to sort of understand, are there actual open textbooks available? Because it became very clear that professors really wanted to use open textbooks as opposed to creating their own resources right away. We found maybe five examples of high-quality open textbooks at this time, which is exciting, but it wasn't going to be able to provide resources for every professor to be able to use. And we worked together to build this campaign around these five open textbooks to get students to reach out to their professors and make the case that if these materials were to future graduates who are trying to get out there and talk to professors and make the case that, you know, we could only find ways to take more of these materials. We could significantly reduce costs for students and expand access and provide new ways for teaching and learning to improve. And this kind of spoke me all up after last night. I can't even. I'm so afraid I'll say last night. Thank you for this. But no spoilers. Our first effort was what we called an open textbook statement of intention. We got over 1,000 professors to sign on to this within the first couple of months, but then it later expanded to over 3,000. We sort of use this statement that basically says when professors sign it that, you know, I'll use an open textbook if there was one available that was good for my kids. And during the summer of 2008, we used that event to actually attract news and mass media attention to the idea of open textbooks. Summer of 08 helped cement the idea of textbook affordability into the larger college affordability narrative, but also the idea of open educational resources as a viable solution. So, you know, back in 2008, when there were just a few examples, it was hard to make the case for this stuff. It was very easy for people to say, you know, there's lots of quotes, especially from the traditional publishers, saying, oh yeah, there's no free lunch. You know, how could free materials be high quality? But these series of articles really helped elevate this idea and legitimize it and advance the conversation forward. So, you know, the USA Today, Time, LA Times, NPR, Wired, New York Times did an editorial on this idea, Wall Street Journal. And over time, the number of open textbooks began to grow. And we had, through the student organization I was working with, we actually built the first open textbook catalog where we collected a bunch of textbooks and put them online where professors could go and search for them. We had some professors like write reviews of them. And that actually helped us launch a broader campaign to reach out to professors called the Textbook Rebellion. And this is an interesting chapter because it involved a cross-country band tour. This was 2011. And two giant mascot costumes. Mr. $200 textbook now, he Mr. $400 textbook now. And then textbook now kind of looks like while supposed to be an open textbook. And we put those in a van that took 40 campuses across the country, starting in Boston and ending in Seattle by way of Phoenix. What this helped do is really elevate the visibility of open textbooks on campuses and engage students in doing more outreach to their professors to actually provide examples of textbooks that they can use in their courses. Since then, students have continued to be really driving force behind the open education movement. The hashtag textbook world campaign has been enormously successful at raising the visibility of textbook costs on campus. You can search textbook growth on Twitter, you can see all of these examples of students who are holding up signs that come up face down textbooks. You know, you're hearing us as an example from the video earlier, and these like graphs where students have graphed what their spending is. And students continue to be a radical partner in helping to advance these issues, because why is this book? It's for students. And their voices are an important part of catalyzing change on campus. So, out of that, in 2012, was sort of the next big inflection in the open education movement. And this is actually when I shifted my career, moving away from working with students and actually moved over to work with SPARC, a library membership organization. So in 2012, a couple of big things happened. So one is Rice University announced OpenStax. That's built, which many of us are all, as you know, are a set of really high-quality, peer-reviewed open textbooks and high-enrollment subjects that are very widely used, which really helped advance the conversation forward a lot more rapidly. This was around the time also that the Open Textbook Library was established by the University of Minnesota, which provided a lot of great information for faculty of until this point, the library community, of course, is aware of the high cost of tech. But there has been this perception that, you know, textbooks are the territory of the western. Libraries have all of the other books on campus, but textbooks are western shops. Even though students would line up at the reference desk every semester asking for access to their textbooks, it was the western shop that had those materials. But as conversations started to happen about digital materials being used on campuses, libraries, of course, which had many, many years of experience in negotiating those types of deals, now they have to contribute to the conversation. And then also the growth in textbook reserve programs and lending libraries that were helping students provide or gain access to their materials on more of an incremental basis, and really thinking about the bigger picture of, we can transform the scholarly journal market to open access. There are ways that we can contribute to the conversation for open educational resources as well. So in 2013, SPARC launched our open education initiative. For those of you that don't know SPARC, we are a library membership organization that operates across the world. Our core membership is here in the U.S. and Canada. And our work is to make open the default for research and education. And for the first 15 years of our history, it was really focused on scholarly literature and open access. But in 2013, we expanded to add open education and open data as program areas, recognizing that the library community was really thinking about academic resources more broadly and the full lifestyle cycle of knowledge generation, the data that underlie research, publications that perform research, and the educational materials that communicate and pass down that research to the next generation. And our initial programming involved starting the SPARC Libraries and OER Forum. About 30 librarians community identified who had an interest in this issue. We got them together on a couple of calls and set up a listserv that is now over 1,200 people. And it continues to be a vibrant community practice. And leveraged that community into organizing the first ever libraries back at the annual Open Education Conference, which is one of the biggest, or the biggest, events of the open education community. SPARC was a partner in organizing that in Washington, D.C. in 2014. And that really, I think, was the point at which library involvement in the community was really embraced. Up until this point, the OER movement was largely driven by visionary faculty and instructional designers and students. But this is when libraries emerged onto the scene as a force. And now it's hard to even imagine what the movement would look like without the involvement of librarians. So libraries started to establish major open education initiatives. Some of the early ones that gained a lot of traction, Oregon State University launched an open textbook publishing program in partnership with the library, University Press, and Extension Campus. UMass Amherst popularized the model of OER mini grants, building on the first example that was from Temple University, which has since been adopted by dozens and dozens of campuses across the country, including, as I mentioned before, UNCG. And, you know, the impact that these kinds of programs can have is really astronomical. You know, here at UNCG, the first round of grants was $150,000 in savings. Huge impact for students. We also started to see OER library positions start popping up, and becoming just the way that scholarly communication librarians became a type of job. OER librarians became a type of job. Oklahoma University is the first to really launch that type of position, but now there's a couple of dozen librarians who carry that kind of title, and many, many more who have OER in their job descriptions. And library student partnerships continue as well. And while this example from Texas A&M University, where the student government and the library partner to provide teaching award to faculty, so that they could reward and recognize faculty who are doing innovative things with open educational resources and sort of providing incentives for career development. which is sort of the present era. Sort of 2017, I would say, is about when this transformation started to happen. That was around the time of the 10-year anniversary of the Cape Town Declaration and sort of the early work on raising awareness about the educational resources I talked about initially started in this year. The UNESCO, who coined the term open educational resources and also created that interesting logo, held their second global congress on open educational resources, bringing together delegates from over 100 countries to talk about worldwide advancement of open educational resources. You know, examples like Poland, where in their K-12 program they developed open textbooks as part of their digital schools initiative, or Brazil that adopted an open licensing policy as part of its textbook purchasing procurement process. At the same time, their work here impacts care at home on the marketplace. So this graph, you can see after about 2017, that squiggly line starts to look very disruptive. Things are starting to change. And while OER wasn't the only factor causing this, it was a significant one. If you look back at the market analysis of major publishing companies in the space, OER is cited as one of the reasons that that market has started to transition and change. And we'll talk about that in a second. On the OER side, there was just a study put out by the Boston Survey Research Group that looked at the adoption and awareness of OER for the 17-18 school year and found that 13% of faculty say they're using OER in at least one of their courses. So, you know, there's some ambiguity over whether these are actually open licensed materials or maybe just creative resources that are used alongside existing ones, but nevertheless, 13%. You know, remember when there were 5 open textbooks, that's when this started. This is an enormous progress. And if you look in sort of the progression of how we got there 2 years ago, that it was 5% of faculty entering that competition. Now it's 13%. Similarly, with OER awareness, that's also on the rise. This year, for the first time, 46% of faculty, so almost half, say they have some level of awareness about educational resources that they don't necessarily need. They are using them in their courses or have a full understanding about how to do that. But that's why the involvement of libraries is, it provides that connection on campus. So you can start the conversation, libraries can help finish it. And, you know, our friendly $400 economics textbook, there is an OpenStax Principles of Economics textbook that is free online. You can download it as a PDF, you can view the full text online. You can actually view the chapter on price elasticity, which is the economic concept that describes how they're able to charge the $400. and, you know, this is common. This textbook is wide open, textbook is widely used. OpenStax says that nearly half of colleges across the country are using open educational resources. On a policy side, things are also developing rapidly. Last year, for the first time, the U.S. Congress appropriated funding to support open textbook grant programs at colleges and universities. $5 million in the past 2 fiscal year budgets and in the next fiscal year. And while $5 million in the context of the federal budget is a small amount of money, it is a really significant statement that our elected representative, the highest level of government, says that, you know, not only is textbook affordability an important part of the college affordability debate, but open textbooks are the strategy that we endorse to get there. Students and faculty have gone up on the Capitol Hill and spoken with lawmakers, actually just in March during the Open Education Week. SPARC and our allies had a sit-down meeting with Senator Durbin from Illinois, who was the lead sponsor behind that provision, and face-to-face to thank him for that funding and hopefully accelerate the transition toward permanently authorizing a grant program. There's legislation that's just been reintroduced in Congress that would make a program like that permanent. But meanwhile, there's lots of exciting stuff happening at the state level. So all of the state if DermVet has some kind of state level OER program or policy. And whether it's at the K-12 or higher ed level, this ranges from requirements to mark OER in course catalogs so that students can find during registration which courses use OER. There are examples of state-funded initiatives. I know that there's currently a state funding for OER, maybe through your state house here in North Carolina. About a dozen other states have enacted similar appropriations that have had some really significant impacts for students. There are also examples of OER task forces being formed by state governments, state-level open licensing policies adopted by system offices that ensure that materials are freely shared when they're created with public funds. And the kinds of impacts that we're seeing with open educational resources are really significant. So we did this one roundup where we were able to tap $1 billion in worldwide savings through open educational resources over the last decade, which is really, really significant milestone. There's a ton of academic research coming out, peer-reviewed studies that look at students who use open educational resources in place of traditional textbooks. That's finding that students do at least as well, but often better. Also looking at students' perceptions of quality and whether the materials are more tailored to their learning. And there's some really promising signs in those studies. One in particular, there's just a study published last year by the University of Georgia that found specifically not only did OER improve the outcomes for all students overall, but the greatest gains accrued to students who are most likely to be underserved by the traditional system. So how eligible students apply in their socioeconomic status, students of color, and frontline students all did proportionately better when using open educational resources to provide a direct link of OER with equity. There's also really exciting things happening on the pedagogical side. There's this great project called the Open Pedagogy Notebook that is collecting case studies of where faculty and students are working together to use open educational resources to actually building and improving materials and assignments. Getting away from what are called disposable assignments for students who write papers and then don't do anything with them, have students write Wikipedia articles or have students actually continue to make their textbook better. An example I love is from Robin DeRosa in New Hampshire, who created an anthology of public domain literature for a course she was teaching and used an online annotation tool called Hypothesis to work with students to add annotations. Because when you buy an anthology, it's really just about the annotations added on top of the primary source material. And why not engage students in developing that and critiquing each other and learning from each other rather than reading something somebody else produced? So lots of exciting things happening in the open education space. And when we talk about the future being open, this is what the future means. But I said I'd come back to what was happening in the traditional market, because there's also a lot happening outside of the open education space that we need to be paying attention to. OER is not happening in a vacuum. And there are real threats to our ability to make the future open. And one of the interesting developments in the market is that the traditional textbook publishing industry has really started to co-opt the narrative of textbook affordability and even talking about open textbooks. If you told me 10 years ago that the Association of American Publishers, the main lobbying force behind the traditional publishing industry, would put out a press release with this headline talking about how they are making textbooks affordable, including offering OER, I wouldn't believe it. If you look at some of the materials that publishers are putting out, San Diego Learning, one publisher, put out this study that looks at all of the negative impacts that high textbook costs are having on students. Actually, they got into a little bit of a trouble in using some of these statistics and marketing materials, talking about how students get meals to afford textbooks in order to sell more of their products. That's really found out. say the leader this week, I will. But at the same time, the success of the open education movement, publishers have been working to capitalize on that. So most of the major publishers now offer open offerings. This is that company, Cengage, is open now, where they've taken mostly open staff textbooks, but other content too, and sort of curating it, and then professors can assign it in their courses and have students pay for access. So, you know, there's some value added, or, you know, the claim is that they add value by curating the materials and helping professors get it into their LMS. And there's nothing inherently wrong with adding value to those materials. There is something wrong with doing that, putting it behind a paywall and still paying for them. Course is starting at just $30. In the words of our friend, and you don't mind for you. Macmillan, another publisher, put out a similar product for like a hot minute. And if you go to their website now, there are like free open courses. There's a big banner at the top that says, "Are you a student? Purchase here." Headlines like this. Oh, yeah, how do you make OER free? OER is already free. We have a responsibility to hold the line on the meaning of open. It's free plus permission with the bylaws. Behind a paywall, you can take openly licensed content and put it behind a paywall, but you can't keep calling it OER. So it's not just this. There's also the counter model to OER that the traditional publishing industry has started pushing, called inclusive access, which I maintain is a really bad misnomer, because the idea of inclusivity is all about bringing people in, as opposed to inherently making materials exclusive. But this model is at its core intended as an affordability measure. It's a deal between a publisher and an institution where students are automatically billed for access to their digital course materials at a discounted price. And lots of institutions and systems are starting to strike new deals with publishers to provide access to materials in this way. Best intentions, a Hyperlink announced a page partnership and has posted some pretty significant discounts off of print prices of textbooks that probably do benefit from students. But it's really interesting to see. So we see these kinds of headlines about OER when we talk about how much money it saves students. Publishers are starting to put out headlines like that too. Like McGraw-Hill has saved students $55 million through their inclusive access program. Is that savings that you just charge them all? Right? So this whole inclusive access model is being driven by pressures in the textbook marketplace. That's the squiggly line on the graph that we're in. Textbook publishers have started to hit the wall. They've priced themselves basically out of the market. Students are no longer willing to pay the really high prices, and they've been forced to shift an industry. And this is the direction that they've gone in. And it's finally exacerbated by the fact that the textbook publishing industry right now, and for many years, has been monopoly by major companies that control the vast majority of the market. And as of last week, or 2 weeks ago, two of the largest, the second and the third largest McGraw-Hill and Cengage have proposed to merge. So that would essentially create a market where there are two giant players and then a few other smaller ones. So Pearson, and they're going to call the new company McGraw. This was my suggestion. But especially relevant to libraries. There's also one of the main parts of this merger is part of it is pushing for inclusive access on a much larger scale by pooling the resources of the two companies to be able to do it faster rather than competing against each other, which is why we compete. The other piece of it is this new full catalog subscription offered by Cengage called Cengage Unlimited, which for a low price of $120 a month, students can get access to all of their sending questions, which in some cases, if you're assigned four of them, you know, that probably answers the same question, but maybe not at this moment. And SendNation has been aggressively marketing this, and it's less attractive when it's only one publisher says textbooks, but if it's also going to include McGraw-Hill's entire catalog, that starts looking a lot more like something that could be off, especially as a full catalog subscription provided by the university. And you know, SendNation is talking about SendNation Unlimited as a Netflix-style model, even though you can get access to all of the TV shows, movies, and music you could possibly want for less than it costs to subscribe to this semester. But anyway, we as libraries know we are full of catalog subscriptions, right? Think back to 2000 when we started to sign big deals. This is the big deal of the publishing industry. We're at the very beginning. So it's important to learn from the scholarly journal market to predict what the future of this could look like. We're only just starting to get out of the big deals that have been inflating library, or not inflating library budgets, inflating library costs for many years. And we shouldn't go down that road again without asking a lot of questions. So there are also a whole set of other issues that are raised by these models that institutions are going to need to grapple with. So many of you may have seen the scandal at ASU a couple of weeks ago where a professor was requiring students to pay for a homework system in order to do their homework. And there's also a lawsuit going on in the neighboring state of South Carolina around the inclusive access system there, where students, you know, are supposed to be given the ability to opt out but weren't. So there are a lot of ethical and legal questions that we're going to need to navigate as institutions. We're only at the beginning of talking about kind of student data, the digital textbooks, and develop and capture. And what is happening with the data that textbook publishers are going to be able to harvest if students everywhere are now using digital materials that weren't built automatically for. And as we start to think bigger about the academic infrastructure space, and again, taking some lessons from the scholarly publishing space, how we're seeing companies like Elsevier requiring key pieces of infrastructure, Mendeley, these types. Are we going to start seeing that in the textbook publishing world too, where someday textbook publishers may know about more about students than their institution does? And back to Game of Thrones, we can paint a really dark picture about what the future can look like if we see and control the publishing industry to manage our content, capture data, and sell back analytics to the institution, and be beholden to those kinds of systems. But we know that's happening because it's happening right now. The terms and conditions that are going to define the future of what the space looks like are being decided on now. And we have an intervention opportunity where we can work with our senior administrators, our institutions, to make sure that the contracts that we're signing have students' best interests at heart and aren't giving too much away to textbook publishers that they could capture and exploit in the future. And this is an area that SPARC has been working on. This is one of our priorities for the last year. We produced a landscape analysis that provides a more detailed look at the current textbook market and some of these drivers, and what we can do both collectively and individually to plan for the future. So I want to come back to this idea, or the theme of the conference in terms of the future is open. And we are facing threats that could prevent the future from being open. And the idea of leadership is not just about envisioning an open future, but it's about discipline. Leadership is about action. Individual, collective, small, large, and we all have a responsibility to think about how we can contribute to making the future open. And bringing it back facing personal struggles in terms of how to lead moving forward. When you've done all of this work to advance for the art team, great. And now the textbook publishing industry is coming in and using our argument to push a model that actually threatens the future of open world. And I want to share a couple of pieces of advice that I actually got. It came from a program that SPARC's done called the Open Education Leadership Program, which we started in 2017 as a way to help empower library professionals to lead forward initiatives on their campuses, recognizing that advancing open education isn't just about learning the technical skills that you need to support faculty, but it's actually about leadership and advocacy and being able to step outside the library and see yourself as a force for change, bring together stakeholders, drive the conversation with people up. And I was on the phone with Jeanne Milgar, who's a librarian here in North Carolina. She's one of our fellows in this year's program. Everybody in this year's program are turning in their final reports right now. So it's been so exciting to read all of their lessons learned and actually share the what was going through my head in terms of the leadership challenges that I'm struggling with as a national advocate for open education. And Jeanne gave me some really helpful advice that it's not all on me. It's not all on my shoulders. And I think this is a generalizable piece of advice that sometimes we all feel like it is on our shoulders to create change. But the important thing is that there's actually a huge community of people who care about this. Well, at the beginning of this movement, there wasn't. There is now. Here's another quote from the final report of another leadership fellow, Katie Hardy from Dartmouth. There's so many people in the open community who want others to be successful and who are willing to help. It almost never makes sense to work on it alone. We don't all need to be perfect. It's okay if it's not exactly right, the most important thing is taking action. And Michelle Brown from the University of Ottawa echoed the lesson that I learned early on in my career that failure isn't failure, it's an opportunity. And you should take not look at the risk of failure as something that should stop you, but instead take those risks and make the most of any change you're able to achieve. And then Anna Neyman from Worcester Polytechnic talks about how small actions are meaningful. And even if the change we may want to see in the world is much bigger, there are actions we can take right now, conversations we can have, alliances that you can build on campus that can move sustainable forward. So these are all ideas for how you can meet the future with them. And I want to close by talking about the importance of leadership not just being about action, but also understanding motivation. And we use this phrase, it's not about open. We are open advocates because we care about open. We care about open because it is a meaningful value. Open in order to. And what comes after the ... is different for every person, for every institution. I actually went through and looked at a bunch of institutional missions of North Carolina institutions and, open in order to redefine the public research university and inclusive, collaborative, and responsive institution. Back up, open in order to open the door to high-quality, accessible educational opportunities. Open in order to invest our knowledge and resources to enhance access to learning, foster the success and prosperity of the rising generation. Open in order to create and sustain an environment that values students' unique backgrounds. And nurture a culture that supports unique success. So find open in your mission, whatever institution you're at, wherever you are. I think it even fits with the NCY's mission of open in order to better support education, enhance economic development, and improve the quality of life for North Carolinians. And I think you're really lucky here in North Carolina that you do have statewide leadership, and it's really exciting to see the kind of resources that are on the NCY website for the Open Education Initiative. And I really appreciate the chance to speak with you here and hopefully provide some motivation to think about ways you can step up as a leader and not be afraid of taking risks, because even small steps have an impact. And remember that at some point we're all students in the other way. But what can come out of taking action is sometimes unpredictable. And all you need, the only way you'll ever know, is if you try. And if we all take this small step,